So this is good. We're doing good. We're doing real good. We're on our way. Okay, let me just add that to the tally here. That'd be plus 47, 9, 5, carry the 1, makes $656 million, which means we can keep the program.
From a distance, little baby boy. Yeah, da-dee.
Hello, Dave.
Hello there, Dave. How are you?
Best year of my life, Dave.
Say again?
I said best year of my life, Dave.
Obviously, it's not the best year of your life, Dave.
No, it's not. Just for the record, for anyone that was confused.
Right.
I saw a weird thing today.
What'd you see?
And I want to do a thought experiment with you, if you're up for it.
I'm up for anything right now.
You've got to commit. Sunday night. You really got to get into this.
Can you make it quick? Because I want to check out The Last Dance over at ESPN.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I was thinking about The Last Dance, by the way.
It's so good.
It's so good. It's so much better than our show.
True. But they have more of a budget, and Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen, and Dennis Rodman, and Phil Jackson. We don't have any of those guys. We've got you, which is like Doug Lambert Jr.
Doug Lambert? Is that Bill's brother?
Bill. I didn't want to use his real name.
Oh, Lord. That's smart.
I figured we continue not you. Doug Lambert Jr. And I don't know. I'm Jerry Krause. I lost some weight. Is that his name? Jerry Krause?
It was Jerry. Jerry Krause. I grew up in that area. Like, I lived in Northwest Indiana until I was 12 in the Chicago TV market, like in what they call the region. And Jerry Krause is such an authentic Chicago region character. He's amazing.
If they named a hot dog after him, I wouldn't eat it.
No,
he was just,
how would they name it if they were going to name a hot dog after Jerry Krause?
Well, there was a great place in Chicago, Hot Dugs. I don't know if you ever went there.
No, that, I think you're thinking of the bar. You're thinking of the Wiener Circle. Hot Dugs was that bar he kept trying to get everybody to go to.
No jokes.
After that show in the Riviera.
Hot Dugs was a great, they named all their hot dogs.
Did you say hot dogs or hot dugs?
Hot dugs. D-O-U-G-S.
Are you sure?
Oh, I'm positive. Let's go to the internet.
What did you order at Hot Dugs?
This guy was amazing.
I bet he was.
It was out towards the factory where Midway entertainment systems were in Chicago. They made video games and pinballs. And Hot Dugs named all their hot dogs and sausages after rock and roll stuff. So they would have a Clash dog and John Doe dog. So it was good. But I bet you if they had a big fat burger, it would be the Jerry Krause burger, sausage burger. But anyway.
I want to encourage our viewers to sometime in the middle of this coming week to come back to our Facebook page for an edit in which I take everything Dave said just now wildly out of context and create a whole new meaning.
I know they went out he closed the place. It was a great place. Oh, mm-hmm. My God. And duck fat fries. That's right when there was a big problem. They started making them illegal in Chicago. Murder is legal in Chicago, but duck fat is not.
You can draw a straight line from duck fat to murder. You know, it's a gateway fat.
Yeah.
Next thing you know.
Dave, are we going to do an experiment?
Yeah, let's do that thought experiment. You want to?
All right. Come at me.
Close your eyes, Dave.
Okay.
Now, Dave, you're in a coma.
All right.
You've been in a coma for, let's say, 6 months. You're alone in a hospital room. Mm-hmm. You wake up today. Machines all around you. You're on a morphine drip. That's kind of nice.
Do I wake up now, or is this...
No, you keep your eyes closed, but your character...
My character wakes up. Got it.
Your character in your imagination, he wakes up.
Got it.
Alone in a hospital bed.
Yeah.
A nurse who is not in the room, who must have been treating him earlier, maybe administering the morphine drip.
Oh, I love the morphine.
Had been watching television, and the TV is still on.
Did you mention already that I have morphine drip?
You do. You are on a morphine drip.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah. Yeah. It feels nice.
Oh, it does.
Anyway, the TV is on. There's a TV on. Uh-huh. You open your eyes.
Do I open them now?
for the first time in 6 months, you open your eyes, you come out of a coma.
Wait, do I open my eyes now?
Not yet, but very soon, I'll tell you.
All right, so in the dream, I'm opening my eyes.
In the dream, you are opening your eyes. You see a television in front of you. These are the first words and images you see after emerging from a six-month coma on the TV that the nurse has left on. Okay, real life Dave can open his eyes and watch the video now.
Open my eyes.
Open your eyes and press play.
I think it's premature that we open our beaches. I'm a huge proponent of public beaches, and I've been fighting for that for years. But I think that the danger of bringing all the people here to our area and spreading the virus, and I think it's going to prolong the recovery we have. And I think that we should take better measures. And it's drawing people from all over the world to our beautiful beaches. It's too soon, and it's not appropriate.
Thank you, Daniel. Now, Daniel is going to be beginning his protest right now, and he's going to be at a bunch of other Walton County beaches throughout the day. We're going to have his full story and how people are reacting later tonight on News 13. Reporting live in Miramar Beach, Faith Graham, News 13, Panhandle Strong.
All right, Dave, so you've woken from your coma. You've just seen that. That's your first interaction with the world. That's the first information you've processed about the world in which you've woken up. Okay. What is the first question you're going to ask?
Is everyone on acid?
That's close. That's close. Judges? No, I'm sorry. That you were very close, but the correct answer is, can I have a little more of that morphine, please?
Oh, morphine. All right. Damn.
Yeah. Damn. Listen,
cool.
I don't know. Yeah. I've gotten a few questions. Actually, I've gotten one question. How did you and Dave meet? And the short answer is we met through a band, through the band Guster. We're both friends with those guys, and we met and became buds. But there's a longer answer, and it's more sort of convoluted and a little, it's more interesting, to be honest.
I think it's definitely more interesting. My grandfather played baseball in a Hebrew baseball league called the Son of David.
The House of David, I believe it was.
No, the House of David, right. Excuse me. The House of David. And they used to frequent...
Let's see if you're going to say the same thing, because in my family, there was a certain lore around... My grandfather and Dave's grandfather actually knew one another. My grandfather was not Jewish.
But they met at a house of ill repute. How's that?
At a whorehouse.
A whorehouse is another way to say it. Sure.
That's how we said it back in Indiana.
And they met there. And your grandfather did not have the leverage, the VIP power that my grandfather had, because my grandfather played for the House of David baseball team.
Right.
So he could go to the top floor. There were three floors in the whorehouse. And my grandfather was on the third floor, and your grandfather was on the first floor. So he saw my grandfather. They met at the bar, and they talked for a while. And your grandfather, who was not Jewish, grew loads of facial hair for some of this stuff, right? He grew facial hair.
He did. He couldn't. He was never able to grow. My people, we can't grow mustaches, but he did grow quite a beard.
And he joined the baseball team, and then he got to floor number three. He got all the VIP privileges that the House of David team got, and that's how far we go back. Do you have any pictures? I have some pictures of that.
Well, I have some pictures from once he joined up with the team.
So this is your grandfather right here, right?
Yes, that is Johan.
Johan, which is not a Jewish name.
No.
At all, but Johan.
He did actually, but I think actually in that photo, when that image was made, he was known as Jakob.
Okay, and this is my grandfather right here, and his name was Jesus.
I thought his name was Bert.
Nope, Jesus. Bert was his middle name.
Oh,
Jesus Bert Schneider, right there. Jesus.
I have some photos. Let's see. Hang on.
While you're going to yours, just so you know. This guy right here. You know Mumford and Sons?
I do.
This is one of their aunts.
Oh, that's a woman.
Well, it was a woman, yes. She was one of the first bearded players in House of David, and she is the grandmother or aunt of Mumford and Sons.
That's Mrs. Mumford.
Mrs. Mumford, yeah. Right here. Are you familiar with the Wahlbergs?
I am. Yeah. Is that of the Wahlbergers? I sure am.
Well, Wahlbergers, but this is before that. Right here, we have Wahlberg. Wahlberger was their Jewish name. Right here, we have Mordechai Wahlberger. Right there. This is Mordechai Wahlberger, whose grandfather, I think he's a great-grandfather, not a grandfather of Mark and Donnie. So there's Mordechai Wahlberg again, and Wahlberger. And they changed it to Wahlberg, which isn't that not Jewish, but they, you know, but you could see he's a Wahlberger. I mean, if you look at that guy, that's that's a Wahlberger.
You know, this is blowing my mind. I didn't realize there was such a deep music connection because this photo, my grandfather is not in this photo. And I can't really spin it around because it's on the blue screen. But when I found it in his photo album and I turned it around, these guys are brothers and their last name is Avett.
Oh, they're from the, oh, yes, yes, the Avett brothers, right?
Yeah, I think these guys probably are, I think the current, you know, popular band, the Avett brothers, I think they're probably descendants of these Avett brothers.
Oh my gosh, who knew? Who knew? Now, are you from, go ahead, go ahead.
Well, yes. I was going to say also, these guys... also on the House of David, I think this was a couple of years later. These guys actually, their relatives moved to Louisville, Kentucky, and you know their great grandchildren are now playing in that band, My Morning Jacket.
Oh yes, My Morning Jacket. Sure.
This is mind blowing, Dave. I can't believe that the music thing and just you and I just runs so deep and so interconnected.
Now we have some friends who work for the great Father John Misty.
Is that grandfather?
That's Grandfather John Misty right there.
Of course it is.
Grandfather John Misty. Boom.
Dave, let's go to our guest.
Yeah, let's go to the guest.
You should intro our guests, please.
I can't.
Yeah, you can. It's your friend. His name is John.
Okay. This is actually John's grandfather.
He's in the lobby. John is in the lobby. Let's bring him on.
All right. Let me just settle down. Coming up, our friend and one of my favorite musicians in the world right now, John Perrin. He's drummer for NRBQ and so many other things. He's doing stuff with Scott McGoy from Young Fresh Fellows, the Minus Five, who was in REM. John Perrin, come on in, John.
Right, he's in the lobby. Come on, he's in the lobby. Let's bring one. John.
You guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
Are you in a room full of ants?
Things in Chicago are great right now. Booming.
So this is a new segment we've been working on, John, and we're glad you're here. So what's bugging you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let me try again. Hey, yeah. John, we're starting a new thing, a new segment, and it's, hey, John, what's bugging you?
I like this thing.
Twice? We did that twice.
That was pretty good, yeah.
You have options now.
Do you want me to get a bug for my curtain and we can do it again? Third time?
Yeah.
Let's get a bug.
This could be an outro. John, do you have 4 hours? I'm going to grab a bug off the internet.
Yeah.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah.
You have anything you want to ask me?
No, why don't you ask me? Oh. Oh, that's pretty good. You can't do it yet.
Why don't you
ask me? Hey. John, we got a new segment, and why don't you ask Dave?
Hey, Dave.
Hey, John.
What's bugging you?
Not much, man. I'm doing all right tonight.
I can't do it. I can't commit.
All right, here, you ready,
Dave? What about you, Dave? Anything bugging you?
I'll tell you what's bugging me. Something's bugging me bad, my friend, and it's really freaking me out.
I would love for it to freak the rest of us out, too.
Hey.
That's pretty good.
So let's talk about this.
Yeah.
Tell me what you think about when you see that.
Tap dancing bats. So I...
This is NRBQ.
I was going to say, when you held it up, it was just a big thing that said Dave.
I know. Let's go on. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. What do I think about that?
What do you think about when you see me?
Tap dance and bats. I actually think of my dad. Uh-huh. That was the first NRBQ record he ever heard when he was a radio DJ at Valparaiso University, and that was the first NRBQ I think he ever heard.
Do you ever have a moment where you think, oh shit, life has a weird circuitous kind of way of going from point A to point B, like your dad putting that record on and now you're sitting behind a kit?
Absolutely. Yeah.
My
entire life is that. I mean, it really is full of the craziest moments, and it's one of the coolest things about that. I mean, the odd thing about my family is we're all musicians, but the thing I didn't realize until fairly recently is like my dad is the first bass player I've ever played with. So not only do we have a really strong bond just because we're fans of the same music, but it's like he was also one of my very first bandmates.
You know, in my mind, like there's not many people in this world that are in a better situation than you musically. Like you're in the band that for us, it plays every style of music that you love. You know, you've fallen into a cloud of music right there with NRBQ. So I'm curious if you got there through your father or your brothers, or this is just, you know, how did this happen?
That's a really good question. I mean, it's wild because so much of the music I listen to now, I mean, really it's all because of my parents. And, right. You know, they bought me a drum set when I was two. They completely encouraged me to play drums and play music every day and to be creative and work hard at it and treat it like a job.
Let me ask a quick question.
Go ahead,
John. So Dave and I are friends with another band, and I saw a clip of them on the internet today, and they're a pretty big band. They've played in really great places, but they were playing in like an abandoned office building construction site for some sort of weird private party.
Yeah.
I saw the video of it. There was a moment where the singer kind of had a moment where he looked around and he's like, you could see it on his face. Like, wait, this doesn't suck. This is awesome. Have you had a gig like that where you're like, you were on stage in the set and we're playing and all of a sudden you're like, oh, what a weird place I'm to be playing music right now, but this is great. Have you had that moment?
Oh God. Yeah, absolutely. By far the biggest moment like that ever, like the most wild, this is insane moment was NRBQ went and played on the Sirius XM Country Cruise. And
I mean,
NRBQ's music is so, means so much to me. Everything that band stands for, everything that band ever did, really means the world to me. And it means the world to me that I'm able to be a part of it and to get to play those songs. And, you know, especially with Terry and those guys are my, you know, some of my best friends. And that personal connection is there even beyond the musical connection. I love all those guys a lot. But the biggest moment of that was playing on that cruise ship. We're playing on the top deck of a cruise ship. And I'm getting to play Wild Weekend as a member of NRBQ. Like, and looking at Scott and Casey and Terry, and just getting to be there was one of the most amazing moments of my life. And I'm so thankful that this, as bad as this stuff is, that it's happening now and I was able to go do that trip and experience that moment, because I'm always going to remember it.
John, that was a great, great answer. I mean, that's my favorite band in the world. So, you know, I used to be stalker guy, but, you know, I'm just saying we're straight. I'm not going to stalk you. But Terry should be a little nervous. Speaking of Terry, Do the Primal Thing is a new single, and it's a nice single. It challenges Anagata DeVita for length, I think.
It's pretty amazing. I mean, there's so many times, and really NRBQ has completely changed my life in every way, just me as a human being has been completely changed by being in NRBQ for, you know, the positive too, but really as a musician.
We got to finish, but so it's do the Primal Thing. It's on Omnivore, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can't say enough about Omnivore, and they're the coolest people ever. I mean, like I'm so lucky to be in this circle of really massive music fans.
Yeah, you're lucky. You've already said it.
Hey, you're one of them. I mean, you know,
Yeah, it's just so cool to what Omnivore is doing to help with Music Cares, and Music Cares is doing so much to help musicians.
Oh, that's right. The Music Cares thing is important. So I won't cut you off on that one.
all proceeds for Do the Primal Thing go to Music Cares to benefit musicians who lost work during this time. And
they've been doing amazing things for tons of guys. We know a bunch of folks around here that totally tapped into Music Cares who would be hurting real bad right now.
All right. So John, we got to wrap this up, but you'll come back in another segment and do a song for us in a minute.
Yeah, absolutely. It'll have to be on guitar, but
that
I won't be able to scream and play drums like I normally do.
John, I didn't want to say anything, but I felt you might've been a little underdressed here.
Yeah, I tried to cover up the stains.
If you could do me a favor, this is kind of a classy show.
Okay.
Go put on like I love green. I love green, and yeah. I love the Pacific Northwest.
All right.
Do something that represents.
Okay.
Yeah, both of those things.
Okay. All right, we'll watch for it. Just give me a thumbs up from the lobby when you're ready to go, and we'll bring you back on.
All right, I'll be right back.
Dave, you know what time it is?
It is time for to celebrate. We still got our sponsor, Dave.
I've heard, and it's we have good news about that.
Great news. Lums is still with us up in Canton, New York. And Cheryl gave me a call.
Well,
and
Dave.
Yeah.
It's Sharon.
Sharon. Okay. Sharon. I'm not good with names. Sharon called me, said everything's going good. Like 7 or 8 people have gone in, mentioned from a distance with Dave and Dave. They get the root beer, they get the John Hancock with the root beer, or they get the Lum Dog. But there's one guy, I don't know what the deal is, if he's a listener or what the deal is, but he's completely taking advantage. He says the name of the show, he gets the root beer, he chugs it, and then he takes off.
Oh, wow. This is one of our viewers that's doing this. Is not what I would expect out of our people.
Just seems like a really lame opportunist, you know?
Yeah, well, I would like to encourage people, you know, our viewers are really nice, well-meaning, sweet people. And I would like to encourage our viewers who do go to Lums and Canton, you know, get the hot dog, have your root beer, maybe get the platter. Show these people some support.
Get the platter.
Do you have any idea who it was?
She sent a photo.
Can we see
it? She sent a photo. I got to find it. She sent a photo of this real rascal. There he is. There's the rascal. Looks like Father John Misty, right?
He does. He looks a little bit like Father John Misty.
Definitely looks like he just made the playoffs in the NHL. Looking good. Joe Thornton.
Go, he baby. looks like maybe he was Abe Lincoln's barber. That's a Matthew Brady photo.
He looks like David Letterman's aunt.
He looks like Will Forte a little bit, actually.
He looks like Martina Navratilova's first husband. All beard.
He's a big beard. You know what he looks like ultimately, Dave?
Who's that?
He looks like Bad News, and I don't want him to represent the viewers of Dave and Dave. So listen, any viewers in the Canton area, please go get a hot dog, spring for the platter, support our friends up at Lums, and thank God John is ready to go. Should we bring him on?
Yeah, that was a long journey.
All right, here we go. John, you ready? All right, from Chicago, Illinois, here he comes.
Took a long time to get back here. wear those clothes. It's a dark victory. You won and you are so lost. Told you were satisfied.
Musical guests here. That was great. That was a Tom Petty jam. I loved it.
That was great.
Thanks, John. That was amazing.
John Perrin, you could find it, you know, he's got a couple solo songs that recently on Bandcamp, but his main deal is he's in NRBQ. They've been touring for 50 years, except right now, but they'll be back on the road. Go see NRBQ, John, Casey, Scott, and Terry. And of course, Clem. So anyways.
All right, Dave, that's show number 3 in the books. Let's wrap this up. We're going to do show number 4.
Show number 4 is going to be good. We're going to bring out our friend Brian Rosenworcel from the band
Kansas.
Guster. Correct. Kansas. They play in Kansas.
Guster.
And that's it. We're going to challenge the Last Dance, the Michael Jordan thing. We're going right up against it. You know, it's a network thing. We're really battling them.
All right, let's roll credits, Dave. I want to watch it myself.
Let's do it.
Bye. See you next week.
Bye, Dave. Oh, want to sing out?
Oh, my God. What were we thinking? Let's bring John in. John, you ready? All right, I'm bringing him in.
From a distance, da-da-dee-da-da-da-da, la-da-dee-da-da-da. Ooh, yeah. See you later, John.
Bye. Bye, Dave.
Bye, guys.
Thanks, John.